The Fourier transform is named after Joseph Fourier. Fourier lived at the time of Napoleon. In fact, he worked for Napoleon. And turns out that he was actually obsessed with heat. He was very interested in knowing how heat propagated through materials of different shapes. And that is what led him to develop the Fourier transform. The Fourier transform basically says that any periodic function, you can basically take a function and sketch it out, and if I make it periodic, it can actually be written as a weighted sum of infinite sinusoids of different frequencies. So just think about that for a second. You're saying that any function can be written as a sum of sinusoids, and that's just one function of different frequencies. So very, very important result. And when he first came up with it, it turns out that the mathematicians of his time, Lagrange, Euler, and others, found the work to be not that rigorous. And it actually took him about 8 years to publish this result. Today, one can say that there is virtually no discipline of science or engineering that has not been profoundly impacted by the Fourier transform. In fact, I would go one step further and say that the technological advances we have seen in the last 50 years, a lot of them simply could not have happened without the Fourier transform. So for those of you who have written a paper that they are very, very excited about and very happy and satisfied with, but have gotten this paper rejected, I hope you find some solace in that story. So now, since we're talking about sinusoids, let's start with a little primer on sinusoids. Here is your sinusoid right here. Fx is equal to A sine 2 pi ux plus psi. Here A is the amplitude of the sinusoid. U is the frequency of the sinusoid. 1 over u is the period. And psi is the shift or the phase of the sinusoid. So let's get back to Fourier. So what does Fourier say? He says that if you have a periodic function, it can be, without loss of information, described using a sum of sinusoids. So here you have a periodic function, which is a square wave. And let's say that the period of the square wave is 2 pi. So let's see how this can be constructed as a sum or described as a sum of sinusoids. So let's take the first sinusoid shown here. And by the way, all of these sinusoids that I show here have been determined by the Fourier transform. So the first one is this one, and you get sort of a crude approximation of the square wave. Let's add one more, and you get that. A few more, third, fourth, fifth, sixth, seventh, and eighth. And now you see that you get a function that looks a lot like the square wave. And this is just 8 sinusoids. If you add a lot more, you end up getting something that looks like this, that is very close to the square wave. In fact, if you could add an infinite number of these, you would get exactly the square wave. So these are not, and once again, arbitrary sinusoids. These are sinusoids that have been computed by the Fourier transform. So what the Fourier transform is telling you is that you can take a signal here, f of x, which where x represents the spatial domain, f of x right here, and you can represent it in frequency domain. U is the frequency right here. And so you can represent it in frequency domain as the sum of several sinusoids of different frequencies, and here are the amplitudes of the sinusoids. And with each one of these sinusoids, each one of these frequencies, remember that you also have the phase of the sinusoid. And in this particular case, you see that the phase flips from pi by 2 to minus pi by 2. That's just the way it works out in this case. So very important, it's not just the amplitudes of these sinusoids, but also the phases of these sinusoids that are really critical. We'll talk more about this later. For instance, if you look at these two sinusoids right here, turns out that they are off by a phase of pi. This is pi by 2, and this is minus pi by 2. So that's sort of a visual illustration of how one can go from spatial domain to frequency domain. So now we can formalize this using the Fourier transform. The Fourier transform represents a signal fx in terms of amplitudes and phases of its constituent sinusoids. It takes you from f of x to f of u, and f here for each u captures the amplitude and the phase of the corresponding sinusoid of frequency u. So that's the Fourier transform, or the forward transform. Similarly, you can go the other way as well, and that's the inverse Fourier transform. And that computes the signal, the spatial signal f of x, from the amplitudes and phases of the constituent sinusoids. So you're going the other way. And so I want to make it clear up front that whether you go forward with the Fourier transform or come back from frequency representation back to spatial representation using the inverse Fourier transform, there is no loss of information. So now let's look at the transformations themselves. Here is the Fourier transform. It's an integral. Remember that at the moment we're talking about everything in 1D. F of x is a 1D signal, and its Fourier transform is also a 1D signal. So this is an integral right here. And the inverse Fourier transform is also an integral, which looks very similar to the Fourier transform integral. But let's start with this one, the inverse Fourier transform. What it's telling you is that this original signal f of x is the sum, because the integral is a sum, of sinusoids of different frequencies. And that's represented by this complex exponential that you see here, e to the power of I, 2 pi ux. E to the power of I theta is cosine theta plus I sine theta, which we will show shortly. So this is where you have your sinusoidal functions. And they're of different frequencies, u, and different phases, and different amplitudes. And the frequency and the amplitudes and phases are captured by the Fourier coefficient right here, f of u. And you can see that the Fourier transform looks a lot like the inverse Fourier transform, where u and x are flipped or interchanged. But the one big difference is that you have a minus I here, while you have a plus I here. So often, the Fourier transform is referred to as the minus I transform, and the inverse Fourier transform is referred to as the plus I transform. So let's take a look at this complex exponential right here. Why is it that e to the power of I theta is equal to cosine theta plus I sine theta? Well, that can be shown as follows. I, by the way, is square root of minus 1. So here you have your complex exponential. And we are going to expand this using Taylor series. And we know how to do that. We know the Taylor series expansion of e to the power of anything. That's this. And then we are going to essentially separate out the terms that have even powers and the terms that have odd powers as follows. And the ones that have odd powers have I on the outside. And this right here, the first term, turns out is the Taylor series expansion of cosine theta. And this right here is the Taylor series expansion of sine theta. And therefore, e to the power of I theta is equal to cosine theta plus I sine theta. Okay. So now let's come back to the Fourier transform. Very important thing to note that the Fourier transform is complex. Why does it need to be complex? Because this coefficient f of u, for the frequency u, you have a coefficient f. It's a complex number because it needs to hold both the amplitude and the phase of the sinusoid with frequency u. And so that's very important. It needs to be complex, and that's necessary for it to be mathematically complete. The second thing to note here is that this integral goes from minus infinity to infinity, not from zero to infinity, meaning to say that we represent frequencies using both positive and negative frequencies. And this is another important attribute that's needed to make the Fourier transform complete. So let's come back to the complex nature of the Fourier transform. So for any frequency u, you have f of u, and that has a real component and an imaginary component. So if you wanted to find out what is the amplitude of the corresponding sinusoid of frequency u, that would be the real squared plus the imaginary squared, sum them up in the square root of that, that is the amplitude. And the phase of that sinusoid is tan inverse of the imaginary component divided by the real component, expressed here as the A tan 2 function. So now let's take a look at a few examples, very simple elementary examples. So let's start with the simplest signal you can think about, which is a cosine function. We said that the Fourier transform expresses a function as a sum of sinusoids. Well, here a cosine function is essentially a sinusoid shifted. So as a result of that, its Fourier transform is a delta function at the frequency k. Remember that k is the frequency of this cosine function. So it's a single delta function at k and minus k, meaning to say that there is only one frequency in this signal. And it happens to reside in the real domain of the Fourier transform. Now, if you add two of these cosine functions, so that is cosine 2 pi k1x, cosine 2 pi k2x, so two different frequencies, then you essentially get the sum of their Fourier transforms in Fourier domain. And so you end up getting four delta functions. K1 minus K1, that's for the first cosine function. K2 minus K2 for the second cosine function. Now let's take a look at the case where you have a sinusoidal function. Well, a sinusoid is nothing but a shifted cosine function. In this case, again, you have only one frequency. You have delta functions or impulse functions at k and minus k. In this case, it's flipped. And more importantly, this resides in the imaginary domain of the Fourier transform. Now let's take a look at the constant. So you have a flat signal. Well, a flat signal has no frequencies. Or another way to think about it is it has only one frequency, which is a frequency of zero. And therefore, you have a delta function at zero right here. And now what happens if you have a signal which is a delta function itself? It turns out that you need equal amounts of sinusoids, equal amplitudes of sinusoids of all frequencies to recreate this sample right here, this delta function right here. So the Fourier transform is flat in this particular case. All frequencies are needed. And here is the rectangular function. It's also referred to as the pulse. It has a width of t, goes from minus t over 2 to t over 2, and the Fourier transform of a rectangular function, which if you remember in the previous lecture, we had also talked about the box filter. So this is a 1D version of the box filter. Its Fourier transform is the sinc function. It's t sinc tu. And the sinc function, sinc tu is sine tu divided by tu. And that function looks like this. It starts off with a maximum value at frequency equal to zero, and then it tapers down, but it has this ringing effect. It has these oscillations that dampen over time. And then as a final example, let's take a look at the Gaussian. So here is your Gaussian, and A represents the width of the Gaussian. It would be equal to sigma squared in this. Usually there's a sigma squared down here to represent the width or the standard deviation sigma of the Gaussian. In this case, we are representing it as A in the numerator right here. But A in any case represents the width of this Gaussian. Well, its Fourier transform turns out is also a Gaussian. And its width is going to be proportional to 1 over A. It shows up in the denominator here. So this is an interesting observation. What it's telling you is that any function actually, in this case the Gaussian function, but for any function, if you scale a function, if you widen a function in spatial domain, you're going to actually compress it in the frequency domain and vice versa. There's inverse scaling going on. So let's take a look at some of the important simple properties of the Fourier transform. First, linearity. Let's say you have two functions, f1 and f2, and their Fourier transforms happen to be f1u and f2u. if you take a linear combination of F1 and F2 in spatial domain, then that the Fourier transform of that entire function is the same linear combination of F1 and F2 in Fourier, in frequency domain. If you have a function f of x which you scale with this factor a, you're going to get an inverse scaling of its Fourier transform in frequency domain. You get u divided by a. So as you stretch the function in spatial domain, you're going to compress the its Fourier transform in frequency domain, and vice versa. If you take a function in spatial domain and shift it by a, you don't need to recompute the Fourier transform. You simply take the Fourier transform of f of x, which is f of u, and multiply it with e to the power of minus I 2 pi u a. And that's it, you're done. You've found the Fourier transform of the shifted function. And perhaps most importantly, you have, if you're finding the nth derivative of the function f of x in spatial domain, and you happen to have its Fourier transform f of u, all you need to do in frequency domain is to multiply it with I 2 pi u to the power of n, and that is the Fourier transform of the nth derivative of f of x. Very convenient.